When I work, I really need a beautiful place. Rome is a perfect place to stay a little bit away from fashion. You can feel the power of this old city.
Before millennials ruled the industry, retail was about playing it safe. Not anymore. What was once considered safe is now redundant. Millennials are hunting for the quirkiest, loudest, most colourful statement pieces around. The most blatant example of this? Gucci. The US $12.7 billion brand that saw a 69.1% rise in operating profits in 2017. Largely driven by millennial spending, it is at the forefront of both the luxury industry and the social media movement. Thanks, of course, goes to creative director Alessandro Michel. A designer heretofore unknown to the fashion world and who has been at the helm of the design team since 2015.
I always try to translate the beauty of the brand in a different language. I can't resist the idea to create another story from the very beginning. It's time for this brand to tell another story. I'm changing everything. It's not a work. It's my life. It's like a love affair. It's like a religion.
In the 3 years since Michel's reign at Gucci, the designer has forged a significant legacy for the brand. The new creative director's changes have made Gucci the driving force behind the move towards asexual and androgynous style and the leaders of a new maximalist approach to high fashion. Michel's gender-bending aesthetic and cross-cultural references, initially regarded as unsellable, have translated into booming business. But before there were anachronistic mashups, plexiglass runways, and even embroidered snakes, Gucci was forging its way as a luxury leather goods brand. Born from humble beginnings in Florence, 1921, Gucci's first incarnation was a small, family-owned saddlery shop. Its focus was on leather goods for the fine horseman, saddles, boots, gloves, and saddlebags. Founder Guccio Gucci was inspired by the luxurious luggage of traveling Parisians whilst living abroad, and soon turned the business's attention to fine leather goods with classic styling. Although Gucci organized his workrooms for industrial methods of production, he maintained traditional aspects of fabrication. Initially, Gucci employed skilled workers in basic Florentine leather crafts, attentive to finishing. With expansion, machine stitching was a production method that supported construction. Together with three of his sons, Aldo Gucci, Vasco Gucci, and Rodolfo Gucci, Gucci expanded the company to include stores in Milan and Rome, as well as additional shops in Florence.
We are like an Italian trattoria. The whole family is in the kitchen.
Gucci's stores featured finely crafted leather accessories, such as handbags, shoes, and his iconic ornamented loafer, as well as silks and knitwear in a signature pattern. The Gucci crest became synonymous with the city of Florence. Film stars and jet-set travelers to Italy during the 1950s and 1960s headed to Rome, Capri, and Florence, where they would snap up trunkloads of Gucci products. Movie stars posed in Gucci's clothing, accessories, and footwear for lifestyle magazines around the world, contributing to the company's growing reputation. The company prospered through the 1970s, but the 1980s were marked by internal family disputes that brought Gucci to the brink of disaster. Rodolfo's son, Maurizio, took over the company's direction after his father's death in 1983 and dismissed his uncle Aldo, who eventually served a prison term for tax evasion. Maurizio proved to be an unsuccessful president. He was compelled to sell the family-owned company to Investcorp, a Bahrain-based company, in 1988.
On March the 27th, 1995, Maurizio Gucci was walking to his office in Milan.
At 8:45 that day, I received a call on my portable. David, someone killed Maurizio Gucci.
Relationships in the family were so bad that few Guccis came to Maurizio's funeral. His daughters were there with his estranged wife, Patrizia, but already the widow's attitude struck some as strange.
She was interviewed on TV and she said, some people die in their bed. Some people have the privilege to be killed.
Ivano Savioni, who it's said acted as a go-between and helped arrange the killing. The other gang members were said to be Orazio Cicala, who allegedly drove the getaway car on the morning of the shooting, and Benedetto Cirallo, the man who it's claimed shot Maurizio Gucci three times, killing him outright. They said they had been hired by Patrizia Reggiani, Maurizio's estranged wife. 51-year-old Patrizia Reggiani was convicted of the murder of her former husband, the multimillionaire Maurizio Gucci, the last in the Gucci dynasty to run the family firm. Father fought son, cousin fought cousin, and Maurizio, who won out against all the family, was finally murdered by his wife.
Meanwhile, the new investors promoted the American-educated Domenico De Sole from the position of family attorney to president of Gucci America in 1994 and chief executive in 1995. The company had previously brought in Dawn Mello in 1989 as editor and ready-to-wear designer in order to re-establish its reputation. Well aware of Gucci's tarnished image and the value of its name brand, Mello hired Tom Ford in 1990. To design a ready-to-wear line.
The hobo bag was very successful in the 60s and we just worked it in different levels and different colors. Then we brought back the moccasin with a horse bit and turned it with a stiletto heel into perhaps the most successful shoe of certainly the 90s.
Tom Ford came to the founding company with vision and style. Having the strong support of Domenico De Sole, Ford wished to maintain a sense of the company's history while updating Gucci's trademarks.
There was an enormous amount of freedom because we weren't selling anything at that time. What did you have to lose?
Ford and De Sole struggled to restore the former reputation of Gucci while redirecting the growing brand to a new level for the market of the late 1990s.
It wasn't a particularly sexy moment. You know, we'd come out of the waif, and fashion was, people were maybe a little bit too afraid to celebrate hedonism on a runway at that moment in time. You have to tap into things at the right moment in time. And I felt that a lot of people felt like I did about fashion at that moment in time. And it was like a light bulb, and I thought, you know, enough of all this crap. I think everyone should just be sexy, and it should be, you know, I was so convinced that that was the way. That I didn't question it for a minute.
By 1999, the house, which had been almost bankrupt when Ford joined, was valued at about $4.3 billion. When Ford left in 2004, Gucci Group was valued at $10 billion.
How hard was it to leave?
It was incredibly hard to leave Gucci, for both me and for my business partner, Domenico De Sole, who is still my business partner, because we're lucky enough, because we were a public company, we took the company public, to operate as though it was our company, and it was. And we delivered very well for the shareholders, and we had complete autonomy. So I never thought I would leave Gucci. As a fashion designer, I was very satisfied, because I was free to create what I felt was right, so it was quite devastating.
The last spring collection, under the direction of Ford and De Sole, was a critical and commercial success. Amid widespread speculation in the fashion press about Ford's heir, the company announced in March 2004 that he would be replaced by a team of young designers promoted from the ranks of the company's staff.
You're really going to dress up. You really want to look special. So there's this sort of split of very casual and very dressed. And I wanted to do that in a very Gucci way. So very casual for the Gucci girl, her tracksuit silk. There's that sort of, you know, sporty element that's very much a part of contemporary life.
The House of Gucci is today owned wholly by the French holding company, Parisians.